A human birth is rare. Man is only one among 10 million animal species. How did we get a human birth? From time immemorial, scientists and scholars have been trying to find out the mystery behind man's birth. Though evolution and involution have been accepted, through millions of years from inanimate matter, man came through animate matter, plant life, animals, and thereafter got a human birth. How did we deserve to be this way? What is the adhikaratva, eligibility? One school of thought drawn from Indian philosophy is that we have done great deal of merit in the past births through sahasra kodi yoni, that is 1,000 crore birth and death, we became a human being. And therefore, we should continue to be human being in all its aspects. That's the theory of the Indian philosophy. Having been born as a human being, we are born in India. India is a great civilization. It's considered to be a Punyabhumi, Dharmabhumi, Tabobhumi, Devabhumi, and so on. India is one of the oldest of civilizations. Some say 5,000 years old, others say 10,000 years old. Even now, that mystery has not been solved. What is the longevity of Indian civilization? Now, in spite of 5,000 years of recorded history, how is it that we have sustained the same civilization? There are 49 civilizations in the world, out of which 48 civilizations are now dead and gone, leaving behind no trace of their ancient glory. For example, Rome, which was a great empire, the Greek civilization, the Alexandrian, Roman, Inca, Maya, Chaldonian, Macedonian, Euphrates, Tigris, all of them have disappeared from the earth. But India has sustained her civilization for 5,000 long years, is still living and vibrant. This is in spite of 69 invasions. India was attacked 69 times. It had a cultural onslaught, 800 years of Muslim rule, 200 years of British rule. Still, India is as it was 5,000 years ago. That shows the vibrancy, the resilience, and the glory of Indian heritage and culture. If you go to now to Rome, mighty Rome, you'll only see the Colosseum. If we go to Egypt, we can only see the great pyramids. If you go to even other places, they're all mere ruins. And therefore, all of us should know, how is it that India sustained this civilization for such a long time? That's because of a profound philosophy, culture, spirituality, ethical and moral values, and so on. In that sense, it has been said, every country, every civilization has a unique genius. India's genius is spirituality. By that, many interpretations can be said, but religiosity, spirituality, philosophy, yoga, meditation, concepts of law of karma, law of rebirth, law of order, and many other aspects are responsible for India continuing to be a living civilization. How 5,000 years ago we conceptualized that man, animal, and nature are in symbiotic relationship. Man worshipped at that time, still continues to worship even today, animal species and plant species. Like that, there are so many unique features of the civilization which ought to be learned by the succeeding generations to come. We are not thinking of just because India is an old civilization, everything that was done long ago is truly correct. Only those aspects, those concepts, those perspectives and principles which are relevant to current times, we only need to take into account. How is it that we were able to manage this? One reason is because India had profound thought and wisdom. One profound thought and wisdom, or an ethical moral as approach to life, is the fact that we have said long ago that noble thoughts come from every side. Ano Bhadraha Kratavo Yandu Vishwadaha. Gandhiji said, I'll keep my doors and windows open to allow all thoughts come into my room, but I will not be swept away from my feet. In that sense, India is the only culture which accepted all that was sacred in the whole world. For example, when conquerors went to Egypt, in the Alexandrian library, 100,000 books were burned. Similarly, wherever civilizations went as conquerors, using religion on one side, ideology at the other, they destroyed animal species, plant species, human beings, and so on. They also erased their culture. But in our case, India never went out of the country either to spread the culture or to conquer or convert people. That's one greatness of India. We also said our ancient saying is that Udara Charitanam Vasudeva Kudumbakam. That means for the large-hearted person, whole world is one family. It's a very great profound thought by which India, long before we thought of this in communication, in travel and so on, has conceptualized of idea that the whole world belongs to one single family. This has been proved by scientific discoveries, how the genetic characteristics of all the races in the world remain the same. Another profound thought of India is her approach towards man, animal and nature. We should know, first of all, that right from the dawn of civilization, man has been fighting four battles. One battle is against nature. The other battle is against animal species. The third battle is man against man, based on religion, ideology, nationality, ethnicity and so on. The fourth battle man has been fighting from the very beginning is what is called man against his own divinity. The divinity within says, do this, don't do this. And that is also, we are always, though we agree intellectually that we should do this, but we practice otherwise. So these four battles have been going on in the world for a long, long, long time. And now crisis has come. 5,000 years ago, population was very small and abundant natural resources were there, and therefore man was living in harmony with animals and nature. But in the last 100 years, because the tremendous amount, rapid population growth, we are now 6 billion people, land remains the same, and consumption has gone up 100 times per capita, particularly in industrialized nations in the world. And therefore, in the last 100 years, much more damage has been done to what you call our earth, which we call in India the Mother Earth. We have been, because of our greed, avarice, and overconsumption, excessive indulgence, wastage, etc., etc., the earth's resources are slowly being depleted. And therefore, the whole world is today in a deep crisis. Many scholars and philosophers think that in a few years from now, life may not be able to sustain in this earth because of the pollution, or what I would call the grazing to the ground, overconsumption, etc., etc. And therefore, the ancient concept of attitude towards nature is very relevant to the modern time. 1950, there was a conference in Rome which said that limit to growth. We can't go on growing continuously. We cannot sustain ourselves if we do that way. Later on, in 1972, we had a stock international conference of what is called Summit Conference in Stockholm, which was followed in 1992 in Rio. In these two conferences, the damage being done to Earth has been discussed in great deal. Each nation pledged that they will not overconsume, they will not pollute anymore, etc., etc. And the recent conference in 2002, we had in the South Africa. There, though at one end, we all were happy with certain things being done to restrain pollution, to reduce deterioration values and so on, still they have pointed out the dangers are still there, a long years to come. The Western concept towards nature has all along been on a materialistic secular, scientific, technological, rational, meaning thereby for economic reasons, for self-sustaining reasons, we are approaching nature. They all talk about exploiting nature, conquering nature, man against nature, whereas in India, the concept is entirely different. We worship nature. Nature is considered to be the mother. Earth is considered to be a mother. Plant life is considered to be brothers and sisters. Water bodies are also respected. Vayu is respected, and so on. So India's concept towards nature is one of worship, one of reverence, one of respect, an ethical, moral approach to the animal species. Can we see how even United Nations has accepted India's concept that Earth is our mother, what is called Matrutva Bhava. UN has agreed, has now put up a large billboard in the UN building saying protect Mother Earth. Thousands of NGOs, individuals, scholars, so many electronic and all media are now appealing to man to be respecting nature, not to indulge in excessive exploitation. Our approach being spiritual, we start thinking of this earth not as an inanimate object, but our mother. One single illustration I'll say, we consider a sun as our source of all energy. Everyone would agree, without the sun, man cannot sustain life in this planet. Pre-Christian civilizations also worshipped the sun. Our concept is sun is considered to be a pratyaksha deva, that means manifestation of God. So we have beautiful sloka saying, O sun, you are giving us so much of energy, so much of consciousness, we are dependent on you, please bless us with long life, health, shreyas, sritva, mangalatva. Bhano bhaskara matanda, chandrasme divagraha, airarogya maishwaryam, shriyam seyam shadehime. The sun itself is considered to be so sacred. Many people think the sun is a manifestation of the divinity. The second concept about nature is our concept towards vayu. None of us can live for more than 2 minutes without air. Air is not nitrogen and oxygen for us. We consider nature as a manifestation presence of God. And therefore, our sloka says, O vayu, I am prostrating before you. You are the great God himself. And therefore, in return for what you are giving to us, we shall speak the truth. We shall observe the law of nature. So we say, Namo Brahmane, Namaste Vayu, Tvameva Pratyaksham Brahmasi. Therefore, Satyam Vadishyami, Hridam Vadishyami. That's the way we look at air. Thirdly, we would talk about water. Next important endowment of Mother Earth is water. Without water, one cannot live more than 10-15 days. In the next world war, according to one organization, the think tank in America, is going to be war for water. Water has become more costly than petroleum and diesel oil. And therefore, water has become scarce all over the world. Due to lack of water, civilizations are disappearing. Mother Earth is not able to produce. And therefore, our concept of water is, according to Atharva Veda, is one of worship and regard. We say, Abhova idagam sarvam vishva bhudanyabaha. Those people 5,000 years ago said that the whole world, 99% of the whole world, including our body, is 99% water. We also respect all water bodies. Just look at the way we look at our rivers. Ganga Chayamune Chayva, Godavari Saraswati, Kaveri Narmade Sindhu, Jalesmin Sannidhin Kuru. Like that, there are so many propitiations. Water is considered sacred for all religions. They bless us through sprinkling water on us. So water also is to be protected, because today all the rivers are polluted, major lakes are polluted, Lake Michigan is polluted, Lake Victoria is polluted, our rivers are all polluted, and therefore man, all waterborne diseases are destroying man's health. And therefore third element which we worship is Mother Earth, water body. And then we can also think of plant body. We all know we are plant life. Our body is sustained by plant life, grows by plant life. That means food grains, vegetables, fruits, herbs, our body is made up of that. So we say this is a God, the it's a kshetra. Body is a kshetra in which the kshetrajna, that's a God, is residing. So in respect, in reverence to what you call our body, anna maya kosha, that means made of food grains. That's why we give a tremendous amount of importance to the body. And therefore we are given so many slogans on this. Plant life is worshipped in India. Tulasi is considered to be symbolic of the plant life in India. Namas Tulasi Kalyani, Namo Deva Priye Shubhe, Namo Moksha Pradeya Devi, Namas Sambat Pradayage. The what is called the temple tree and the banyan tree and many tree herbs, they are all worshipped in India. And therefore all the Panjabhutas in India, including Agni, including Akasha, are worshipped in India. This is done in addition to the scientific, technological, managerial, secular approach to give an inspiration to human beings to respect these endowments. That's why I am suggesting India's approach is one of spiritual approach towards the plant species. And there certain plants are called Sattvaguna, some plants are called wild, some plants are supposed to be Rajoguna. And therefore Karnataka is the only state in India which has got a temple for Annapurneshwari. Annapurneshwari temple, meaning that also is conceptualized as a goddess. Nityanandagari Varavaigari Saunajiratnagari Nirdhutakilagoravavanagari Mata Annapurneshwari. So in a devout Hindu's house, every day this is being recited, that you are my mother and you are protecting me. This regarding earth. As regards animal species also, India's approach is one of great concern for animal and all inanimate species. Lord Buddha was born 500 years before Christ and he is a compassion incarnate. Compassion incarnate. When Buddha found an animal being sacrificed, he came and told, why do you do that? And that man said, I'll go to heaven. Then Buddha said, kill me, butcher me, you will get a higher heaven. That was the approach of Buddha towards animal species. And Buddha's influence is all over the world. Ahimsa paramo dharmaha, that's Vedas say. Lord Mahavira also was a contemporary of Buddha, was also born in India. The first time in the history of civilization, a concept of non-violence, ahimsa, was propagated in our country. Similarly, vegetarianism is a great concept of India. 30% of Indians are pure vegetarians. Another 30-40% eat meat only once in a way. Therefore, India is going to show the whole world the great ideas of vegetarianism. For example, from the non-vegetarian food is harmful from the hygiene, from the point of health, from the point of character. So, any point of view, we can justify vegetarianism from the economic point of view also. One beautiful illustration will tell us how the whole world is going to be in trouble, because 95% of the whole world are non-vegetarians. In the Western world, like North and South America and Europe, they give 10 kilograms of food grains to the animal and they get back only 1 kilogram of food, which means 9 kilograms are wasted, and therefore Americans are consuming typically 2 tons per head per year, whereas in India only 200 kg are being consumed per head per year, which only shows how much is the wastage in the whole world. Somebody has calculated that if Europe and America can become vegetarians, the whole world need not produce any more. That's adequate to feed the whole world. At a time when 200 million people in the world are starving, we are wasting 9 out of 10 food grains for giving to animal. By tracking the food to the animal chain, we are doing a tremendous amount of wastage and overindulgence. It has been proved that half the people in the world are overeating. Apart from that, animal species are inanimate. They also have sentience. They have pleasure, pain, like any one of us. And therefore, a tremendous amount of cruelty is being inflicted on the animal species. 2,000 million cattle, sheep, goat and pigs and buffaloes are being slaughtered per year all over the world. If you take only India as an example, about 150 million large animals, that is cattle and buffaloes, 100 million sheep, goats and pigs are being slaughtered in India, produce 6 million tons of what you call meat, and 500 million poultry birds are being slaughtered, and they are being slaughtered in the most cruel, barbarous, beastly, brutal way, and unnecessarily animals are suffering. It has been said that India is the only civilization which worships animal species, and yet we are so cruel to animals, and therefore we in India, from a spiritual point of view, the cow is worshipped, or the certain animal species are worshipped. Hanuman is a popular god. Ganapati is a popular god. All these are being done in order to invoke in us a certain amount of compassion towards animal species. And to slowly, vegetarianism is spreading, is increasing all over the world. Whereas in India, unfortunately, in spite of glorious heritage and culture, non-vegetarianism is increasing in numbers. A day will come from the ecological, economic, from the political, sociological, hygiene, health point of view, people turn to vegetarianism. Some scholars predicted in another 50 to 100 years, half the world will be vegetarian. And that also is India's glorious health. It has been proved that vegetarian food has effect on the body, effect on the mind, effect on character, and so on and so on. So we have talked about the fight against animal species. There are so many other things that are cruelly killed. The hunting of animals, animal experimentation, putting animals in zoos, putting animals in circus, etc., etc. The saga of suffering of animals is very, very unimaginably cruel to them. Unimaginable suffering is being unnecessarily inflicted on the animal. One more sentence is worth noting to everybody. One animal's livestock alone gives to this country 1,30,000 crores worth of products like milk, work, dung, meat, fiber, etc., etc. 1,20,000 crores. And the Animal Welfare Board of India budget is only 10 crores of rupees. One wretched paisa for 100 animals per year is what you are spending. Even the management of the whole livestock system, they are only spending 6,000 crores. They are very unfair. We are very athermic in respect to animals are concerned. Then we'll come to man versus man. In that, lot of philosophical issues are involved, and that philosophical issues in the sense we consider in our Advaita philosophy that man and man, the divinity, the concept, enthusiasm, the energy, universal intelligence, which goes through all three species of animals and mankind are the same. Like electric power gives energy for lights and fans and radios and television, the same universal energy and consciousness or universal soul is passing through every animal. The Advaita philosophy also further states that the universal consciousness and the individual consciousness are both same, not separately. That means man is not different from God. God and man are the same in the philosophical concept propounded by Shankaracharya. Now we come back, what are the other aspects of the glory of India, unique genius of India? You might start by saying there is a lot of conflict. There are 12 religions in the world. There have been conflict with many religions. Religion to religion, there are conflicts. At this point in time, it's worth noting, the religion is outer cover, whereas spirituality is the inner core of religions. Outer ring, what is it consist of? It consists of a prophet, a set of theories, a set of dogma, creed, a set of books, do's and don'ts, and organization, politics, excommunication, acceptance from the religion, claiming that our religion is better than other religions, that one religion is exclusively, one God created the whole world, and therefore my God is the strongest, mightiest God. Whereas inner core is what is called spirituality, where the spirit is the same in all religions. And therefore India accepted the fact that Hinduism, for instance, does not have any prophet, no book, no scriptures. Even atheist can be Hindu. So Hinduism is a way of life and a view of life and not a religion as per the other. Prophet Muhammad established the religion of Islam. Jesus established a religion called Christianity. Buddha, Mahavira, Zoroaster, Lao Tse, Guru Nanak, all of them following one single God and one set of books. Whereas Indian Hindu religious literature consists of 1 million pages, consisting of 1 million pages of Itihasas to Itihasas, 18 Puranas, 18 Upapuranas, the 108 Upanishads, the Natya Shastra, Gandhava Shastra, Kaudilya Shastra, Nidhi Shastra, Manusmriti, and so on and so on. So one of the greatest thinking in the whole world is here. And therefore, many people think India's spiritual literature is going to dominate the whole world in the next 100 years. Arnold Toynbee, the greatest historian the world has produced, has written that for 2000 long years, India has been attacked, plundered and pillaged. But in this century, India's ancient thought and wisdom will pervade the whole world. Even Swami Vivekananda, the leader of our Renaissance in this country, said, those marauders, those barbarians who plundered and pillaged us and who humiliated us, humbled us in this century, will come to India to pay homage to our ancient rishis and so on. Similar thing has been said by Eugene Davis and many, I would say, Will Durant has written a great deal, Max Muller has written a great deal, at least 200% scholars in the world, including David Frawley, have written that it's going to be India's century. Not said today, even the great first Governor General of India, Warren Hastings, now got Bhagavad Gita translated into English at public expense, at government expense, and also printed it at government expense, and wrote a foreword to it saying that long after Britain leaves India, long after it ceases to be an empire, Bhagavad Gita will illumine the world. That's the greatness of India's spirituality. India has never gone to convert people in other parts of the world. Christians have got 2,400 million followers. Islam has got 1,200 million followers. Buddhism has got 700 million followers. Hindus have only 800 million followers. Christians are in 100 countries in the world, majority. Islam is in 60 countries, they are a majority. And Buddhism in 10 countries in the world. Whereas Hinduism is only in India and tiny Nepal. India never crossed the borders of India to conquer or to convert people. Not only that, we respected all religions as true. It is true that Buddhism went to China, Japan, Thailand and other countries. But they coexisted with the local culture. The culture was not erased or destroyed. But in the case of other religions, they destroyed local cultures, obliterated local cultures and superimposed their culture. Whereas in India, we have never gone outside for conquest or for conversion. That's a great genius of India. Not only that, we respect and revere all religions in the world. It is same as sloka is, like water from the sky falls on Mother Earth and takes different routes through rivulets, streams and rivers, ultimately reaches the ocean, abandoning their identity as a river, merges with the ocean. In the same way, whatever nama rupa, whatever name you give to God, whatever rupa or form you give it to God, whatever kind of attributes you give it to God, everything will reach the same God. Ekam sadhu vivitha padandi. Truth is one, God is one, but scholars and philosophers call the God by different names. And therefore there is a lovely, very very profound sloka, if I may say so. Akashat patitam toyam yatha gacchati sagaram sarvadeva namaskaraha Ishwaram pratigacchati. All prayers, all prostrations reach the same God. That's a great philosophical thing. Therefore, Sai Baba today has got 40 million devotees all over the world. Nobody is converted. Everybody comes to him for his darshan and for his help. Similarly, Amrutanandamayi, from all over the world, people come to worship her or express her gratitude to her. And therefore, but everybody remains. Baba only says, Amrutanandamayi says, great followers have said, become a better Christian, become a better Muslim, become a better Jews. In that sense, Hinduism is only spreading the world of culture, ethical and moral and universal principle. That's another greatness of India. Not only that, when the Jews were sent out of every country in the world, everywhere persecuted Jews, whereas in India is the only country where Jews were never persecuted. They came to Cochin The Cochin Maharaja divided the Bhagavati temple into two and gave one part to them and one part was retained by the Hindus. And when scholars, when priests protested, Maharaja said, they are also my devotees. They have a different kind of dress, different kind of thought of God, different kind of concepts about me, but they are also my devotees. Parsis were driven out from Iran, completely driven out without a single Parsi. Muslims removed all the Parsi Iranians at that time. Where did they go? They came to Surat and told the Maharaja there, we marry with you. Like water, a glass of water, you put salt or sugar, they will merge with you. So the only country in the world where Parsis are living today is in India. So right there when St. Thomas came to India, we told him, you are preachers, you want to preach your religion, is a better religion? Well, go ahead and preach your religion. We will provide facilities for you. We shall provide the infrastructure for you. We shall respect your religion. And in many Hindu homes you will find the picture of Jesus is there. Many go to the church. In Bangalore, Infant Jesus Church, many Hindus also go. In every altar in the house, you will find every God concept is also placed there. And therefore, we are the most Catholic and we are the most, I would say, universal religion in the world, giving what you call acceptance, assimilation, understanding, respect, regard to all religions in the world. In spite of all this, we have been punished and pillaged a great deal. Hundreds of invasions have taken place, 3,000 temples have been destroyed, and so on. That sad story is in the past. It's not use of talking about it. Now what is required by India is interreligious harmony, interreligious understanding, group, so that all things that divide people are removed. That's another approach of India towards other religion. There are 12 religions in the world, and out of which 11 religions are male-dominated. Only Hinduism, if you call it a religion, that is female dominated. The Parashakti is considered to be Durga. And everything is considered Madhurtva Bhava. It's a tree or a mountain or an earth itself. Everything is conceptualized as a woman. And the ultimate Shakti is considered to be Durga. And all of us worship the women goddesses. All the gods, our gods, Brahma, Vishnu, Shiva, are the consorts in Saraswati, Mahalakshmi and Durga. Similarly, great saints and sages of India also had consorts with them. And therefore, there are more temples for women goddesses than for male goddesses. A classic example will be in Kerala, where there are far more women goddesses known by many names. The Lalita has got 1,000 Sahasranama, that means 1,000 names she called by 1,000 names. Lalita Sahasranama is recited by everybody. And therefore the temple names are Durga Bhagavati Devi Maheshwari, Kartyayani Devi Rajarajeshwari, Umashankari Parvati Gauri Amba Bhavani, Sharadambike, Lalitambike, Mogambike, Annapurne, Tripurasundari, Chamundeshwari, Bhuvaneshwari, Kootukulangara Bhagavati, Badre Narayani, Kalyani, Meenakshi, Kamakshi, Vishalakshi, Pangidakshi, Badre Narayani, Kalyani. So you can see how our whole concept is centered around woman. Why? Manu himself said, where woman is respected, God resides. Where woman is revered, God resides. And one major reason for the greatness of India and throughout the ages we have shown is because of the women of India, who are the epitome of sacrifice, suffering, service, kshama, patience, restraint, humility, austerity, contentment, whatever attributes you can think of a good human being are in the women of India. That is why we always respect women. We have conducted recently a program where even the 28 couples were felicitated and they exchanged garland, those who have completed 50 years of married life. In that concept, we should say India considers the family as a primary unit of a society. If the family breaks down, you will find the whole society will be ruined. If family becomes deviant, family becomes estranged, if there is alienation, if there is no cooperation, team spirit, camaraderie, mutual trust, affinity and so on, you will find society will collapse. While if you find now in some parts of Europe and some parts of the United States and other countries of the world, every 5 marriages, 3 are breaking. In some countries, every 3 marriages, 2 are breaking. And therefore, there's tremendous amount of alienation. 100 million children in the world have only one parent. They don't have second parent, no father and mother. The way we respect our father, the way we respect our mother is so high. Mātu Devo Bhava, Pitu Devo Bhava, Guru Devo Bhava. Our other concept is Guru. The Guru teacher is conceptualized as greater than God. Therefore, Guru Brahma, Guru Vishnu, Guru Devo Maheshwaraha. Therefore, we can say in some parts of Maharashtra, even Vishnu had no place. The only teacher had a place. Even Sri Rama had Vasishta. And Atribhavashri was a Bharadwaja, Dalmiya. Everywhere you will find a teacher is he considered to be a near God. And now you can see what the whole world, there is alienation among teachers. Teachers also have become corrupt. They are careerists. And therefore the whole world is suffering on account of not having genuine teachers who are inspiring people. Our Gurukula system in India is unique in the whole world. In the Gurukula system, man, the children were brought up holistically, ethical, moral values, and they, when they came adults, you will find that they are really good citizens. Whereas you find India has become very corrupt, people have become deviant, crime and violence has increased, all because we don't have a spiritual approach towards them. And therefore, our concept of woman as a, and many people in India hear so many stories. Mahabharata was fought for Draupadi's chastity. Ramayana is about Sita's story. And another unique characteristic of India is the husband is known by his wife's name. Rama is known as Sitaya Pati, Sita's husband. Ramasya Patni, Rama Patni is not there. Umayaha Pati, Uma's husband is Shiva. The other thing is not there, I mean the Shivapatni is not there at all. And that's nowhere you find the whole world, not Mrs. Ramaswamy or Mrs. Shashank or Mrs. Gurumat. That's not the way we are talking. The center round is the woman in the house. And therefore, the whole world, when they are the family, is getting ruined, getting separated, so largely due to the ill effects of the media, the electronic, the television media, the celluloid media, where they are using women as a commodity for exploitation. When you go to Washington Museum, you will find how women were being treated in all over the world a few hundred years ago. Whereas in India, they were put on the stake, they were tortured, they were burnt on the stake. Whereas in India, there has been no case a few women committed sati at one time. Maybe one or two are taking place even in India, but no woman took the gun, no woman took the knife to kill somebody else. And Vivekananda has done a great deed. Sister Nivedita, we worship her, a disciple of Vivekananda. Bhagavan Ramakrishna, who is considered to be an avatar, used to prostrate before his wife before starting the day. Tell her, O mother, you are mother of the universe, you are my mother too. Similarly, the Shiva, there is Saundarya Lahari Sloka, where there are 90 slokas in Shiva is praising his consort called Parvati. Shiva Shaktya Yukto Yadi Bhavati Shakta Prabhavidam Naje Devam Devo Nagalagushala Haspanditoi Adastha Maharatyam Harihara Viranja Diviravi Pranandam Stodum Va Katamagata Punyaha Prabhavati. Meaning, where else I can get merit, where else I can get blessing except from you. That's another great idea of India. Like this, if you go on talking, it's the scientific heritage of India is another thing which most people, Indians, do not know anything about the scientific contribution of India. Long before telescope was discovered, long before microscope was discovered, our ancient people, 4,000 years ago, Varaha Mihira, Aryabhatta, Somayajulu, all great men have discovered trigonometry, mathematics, the speed of light, the circumference of the earth, planetary movements, concept of infinity, concept of zero is India's contribution to the whole world. Concept of letters is given by India only. Root of minus one, if you like to talk to A. And also, Akhanda Kodi Brahmanda. That means, Akhanda Kodi means infinite concept number of galaxies. There are 1 billion galaxies in the world, 1 billion stars in each galaxy. That has been also conceptualized. And then the great people have written, George Gamow and Dave Campbell, Thomas Campbell, have written about the discoveries of India in metallurgy, Our Ashoka pillar is considered to be 2000 years old. It has not rusted at all. The Vastu Shastra, the Ayurveda, the astronomy, the concept of etc. etc. Our India's scientific heritage has now come out in 40 CDs. That means 40 hours they have described India's scientific heritage about atom, Anoraniyan, Mahatomahiyan. That means the concept of atom without any instrument, by dhyana, by abhyasa, by meditation, by yoga, by observing silence, these great people of the world discovered many of the truths which are now getting true. We had said the whole world is a myth, it is an illusion. There is no such thing as a quran. That has been proved now through scientific discovery. That itself is a great knowledge to be attained through the concept of scientific heritage of India, on which a number of books are now being brought out. So India was not only a spiritual country, it was a highly scientific country which said that spirituality and science should join together. Like Einstein said, religion without science is blind, and science without religion is lame. This has been proved long, long ago, including the effect of herbs on man. Effects of Deepak Chopra has brought out a whole series of volumes of the tremendous importance and contribution of Ayurveda to the world. The whole thing is going to change. Another great contribution of India, which has spread all over the world, is the concept of yoga and meditation. It is an increase all over the world. There is an enormous interest in yoga and meditation. Yoga, Hatha Yoga, for the body health, meditation for mental health, also balance of the mind. Mind is like a mad monkey, taken liquor, beaten by a scorpion, as somebody said. How to control the mind, how to regulate the mind, through meditation. There are so many types of meditation. In the Indian Heritage Academy, 11 different kinds of yoga and meditation are being taught. All over India, the concept is through meditation you can even approach God. And therefore, self-realization, a concept of how we see the divinity. Ramana Maharshi Ramakrishna, Vivekananda, even Aurobindo has said India will become a world teacher. And therefore, the reason for my going around talking about India's greatness, which is coming also in many others are doing, hundreds of mutts are there, is to make available to the whole world India's spiritual genius, which is 5,000 to 10,000 years old. We should also talk about Sanskrit as a great language which is being neglected. Why, if Sanskrit is being taught in Germany, in other universities in the world, it's a great tragedy that in India no university is teaching. Even in Bangalore, we had a Sanskrit school that has been closed down recently for not having students. The whole world is teaching Sanskrit, and Sanskrit is one language is so scientific that's amenable and adaptable for computerization. It has been said it's based on science. Example, learning is vidya. Vidyapati means teacher. Vidyarthi means student. Vidyalaya means school. Avidya means avidya means ignorance. Paravidya, higher knowledge. Aparavidya, lower knowledge. Like that, all the 4,000 roots are there. Around the 4,000 roots, these are being, all words are brought up. Now it has been said that reciting Sanskrit sloka in the proper way, even the body will vibrate. And Deepak Chopra has written that 3 trillion cells in the body, by reciting Sanskrit in a particular way, you can revive all those things. My friend Mr. Alex is now working on music of India, which is 5,000 years old again, the Gandharva Shastra, Natya Shastra. You can cure people of diseases. Plants will come faster if you put singing, where songs are sung, a particular raga, even that will also come out in a better way. One sentence to show how Sanskrit looks like, if it is recited a particular way, I'm saying, Tacham yora vrini mahe, gadum yajnaya, gadum yajna pade, devi swastir astunaha, swastir manushebhyaha, urdhvam jigadu beshajam, channo astu jivate, sham chatushpade. Compared to all religions in the world, I mean what you call languages in the world, about 500 are popular languages. Indian language, Sanskrit is the only phonetic language which has been constructed to suit our vocal cord, our vocal mechanism. and that's another contribution of India to the whole. Yet another contribution which I would say, man and animal differences. What animal is instinct driven, man is value seeking animal. Those values are more important. A kind of a set of values, I would say, personal values are cleanliness, hygiene, good grooming, or other personal values are honesty, integrity, humility, austerity, compassion, kindness, cheerfulness, courtesy, empathy, friendliness, cooperation, team spirit, sacrifice, service, openness, liberalism, etc., etc., are the ethical values all of us should produce. Education means character building. Education means character building, which has been said by Radhakrishnan, Costa Rica Commission, the National Education Policy, character building. It's a great pity our 330 universities in India, 30,000 colleges in India, 800 management institutes in India, 1200 engineering colleges in India do not teach 1 hour on ethical and moral thing. None of the 5,000 big companies in India are having in the HRD program an element called character building. Sri Chinmayananda used to say, character, education means character building, man making. This is another tragedy which we are doing. Now others are now learning from India that a man should not be not only productive as a professional, as an auditor or an engineer or a lawyer or a teacher or an architect, whatever be your vocation, you should have character is the basis of a society. And therefore, Satyameva Jayate, we say in our emblem, to prove the point that in order for Satya to come, ethical and moral life are very, very important. And therefore, Deepak Chopra has said how you can live longer, 20 years more you can live by observing India's ethical, moral principles and also to japa, mantra, etc., etc. At the other side, because we were at one time animals, we have inherited lot of instincts such as anger, arrogance, jealousy, avarice, boasting, gossiping, criticizing, hatred, all kinds of negative tendencies, lust, passion. 5-6 enemies of man there are 6 kinds of enemies that we classified. We need not say go into the merits of it, but as you say, we are very angry, bitterness, all melancholia, schizophrenia, etc., etc. So we should avoid negative tendencies. Mother Moha Matsarya, there are 6 or 7 varieties of negative tendencies. So India has shown how people used to live for hundreds of years due to this concept of what you call ethical moral life and meditation put together. In the ancient concept, a professional should be half professional, half he should be a sage or a saint. Janaka Maharaja was a ruler, but he was half a sage. Similarly, Atri Maharshi, all the great men had 50% sage. And then in every century, in every part of India, great, great souls were born. In this century, we have now 3 Amardhanamayi, we have many Swamijis, such as Sai Baba. Last century, we had Ramakrishna, Vivekananda, Abhedananda, Yogananda, Ramatirtha, Dayananda, Saraswati, Prabhupada, and Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. I can recite about 100 names of great men who gave the civilization to the whole world. And they were so selfless, they did not even put their name, in whatever they wrote in the Itihasas, Puranas, Upanishads, Smritis, Brahma Sutra, and so on. Bhriguru Vasishtam, Kradirangirascha, Manupulascha, Pulakascha, Gautama. Like that, there are about 200 names I can recite, and that is why India's concept has come. The other concept which India has given to the whole world is concept of freedom. That is why we have got hundreds of gods. Each one letting him be given the freedom to choose the god he likes, what he calls the Ishta Devata. That means somebody wants Guru Ayurapan, somebody Krishna, somebody Rama, somebody Hanuman. Anybody can have any. These are all Nama Rupa. There's only one God. But because we have different, man means a mind. In the mind, whatever pleases to a man, he can go and approach any god for their emancipation or for help. We can approach God like a friend, like a teacher, or like a servant. Whichever way you want to approach God, you can do. Arjuna considered Krishna as a friend, and Draupadi, Radha considered Krishna is a Madhurya Bhava, as a lover. So you can have a variety of ways you can approach God, or goddess, and we are given the freedom to choose any god. In all other religion, only one god, one concept. By freedom is the key point for a man's emancipation. That's why India produced such great philosophies, because of the liberal traditions. Even Charvaka, who denied God, is considered to be a rishi. Buddha was an agnostic, still we worship him. Mahavira was an atheist, atheist who did not believe any god, still we worship him. And therefore India has got the capacity to look always, and Aurobindo has said, we will produce a superman. Man is still evolving. He will become a greater intellectual giant and a greater intellectual spirit. We are the first people to say that we can realize divinity in this birth, not after death in a Devaloka or heaven or hell. We consider by leading an ethical and moral life, by observing the principles, by being loyal to your partner, by being prayerful, by doing action with detachment, with sacrifice, not worrying about the results of your action, or through meditation, or through yoga, or through knowledge, we can achieve greatness. All these characteristics are going to spread all over the world, and every Indian should contribute to this great movement, millennium movement, because this century is going to be India's century, and all of us should contribute a small bit to spread this word, whether it's a marriage function, a rites function, a ritual, or worshipping a tree, or worshipping your parents. Everything should be considered as a spiritual manifestation. Indian chronology says that the universe, the planet, that was 4.2 billion years old. 4.2 billion years old. But Kali Yuga started in 3102 BC, 17th February, Thursday evening. That's the day on which Krishna died and Kali Yuga was born. In the one Yuga, Rama was there. The previous Yuga, Dwapara Yuga, Krishna was there. Satya Yuga, others were all there. In this Yuga, what we should do is be prayerful, act as an instrument of God, act as an instrument of society. Those who don't believe in a God, no harm at all. We can instrument a society. We should work with Nishkama Karma. Nishkama Karma means karma should not be done with kama. Dharma, artha, kama, moksha. You are entitled to any amount of wealth. That's why wealth is considered to be a devi. Namaste sumahamaye, shibile surabhujide, shankhichakragadagaste, mahalakshmi namostude. We can have any amount of what I would call sex. India is not against sex. In both cases, desires are okay. But dharma should regulate both these things. We should be in the median. We should be in the middle path. We should not go to this extreme or that extreme. And for our India can be called to be a dharma. Sanatana dharma, eternal values. The word Hindu is a wrong word. Nowhere in the literature of India, spiritual literature of India, the word Hindu comes. Actually the name is called Sanatana dharma, eternal values. There are local values, time and space, that is called Deshagala dharma. And therefore our Deshagala dharma is one, to be cultured person. What is meant by culture and character? Culture and character. Everybody should have capacity as a manager, ruler, professional, capacity. In addition to that, you have character, culture, commitment, compassion, courage, consistency, consultation. All those characteristics should also be with us. In fact, many people misunderstand culture as only poetry, dancing, music, fine arts, etc. Real meaning of culture is called self-restraint, concern for others. Concern for others. Suppress, avoid a jealousy, envy and so on, anger, but go towards the other one. And therefore, we always, a man is one who lives. Vivekananda had said, those who live for others are alive. Those who live for themselves are more dead than alive. By giving, you become more. And there is even a kindergarten song saying, the kindergarten song, the time to be happy is now, the place to be happy is here, and the way to be happy is to make someone else happy and create a bit of heaven right here. So all of us should create a heaven around us and make this golden planet of ours, which has sustained for billions of, at least 4 billion years, should be made more profound, more sublime, more spiritual, more cultured, more ethical and moral. That's the way we should do, and for which all of us should pray to God, whichever the God, the Christian God or Muslim god or Saurashtra's god Ahura Mazda, saying, they should always say, Buddhir Balam Yashodhairiyam Nirbhayatva Marogata Ajatyam Vatpaduttuncha Ishwaram Smaranat Bhavet. All what I talked so far is relevant to the whole world, irrespective of religion, irrespective of nationality, irrespective of race, ethnicity. This will be relevant. Therefore, India should shine in the years to come. It's going to be India's century. And all of us who are listening to what I have talked today should take on a duty to be messengers of our Mother Earth and also Bharata Bhumi, as we call it, and be helpful to the whole world. It's our, we live for others. That should be our motto, so that their inner happiness will come. All what's going on in the world of external pressures, indulgence, overconsumption, exploitation, jealousy, pettiness, corruption, all these are ruining the whole world. And therefore, India, only country in the world which has got a solution, practical, feasible solution, which can make everybody happy without making anybody unhappy. There are, pleasure is different from happiness. Happiness is forbidden. And I hope this program has been of some value to the viewers of this program. Thank you.